Okay. Well, good morning again to each one of you, and we are glad that we're here. Today our topic is called the centrality of the cross. The centrality of the cross. If we go back a few hundred years, in fact, not that many in relative to time, there was an idea. It was called the geocentric model of the universe. And that geocentric model said basically that the Earth was the center of everything. And the reason the sun moved was because the Earth was staying still and the sun was moving. At first they thought back and forth, and then they finally realized it was going around. And everything was revolving around this Earth. Well, there were some people who had some conflicting ideas about that. One was a Polish man. His name was Copernicus. And Copernicus, he came up with an idea that was called heliocentric. And that was the idea that the sun, and not the center, the Earth was the center of the universe. In fact, he published a book called On the Revolutions of the Celestial Spheres. He published it the year he died. He had these ideas for a long time, but because of the opposition to the church, from the church, he didn't dare publish them while he was young. And that idea was simply that the sun was the center now of the universe. In fact, I think his third assumption was that all the spheres revolve about the sun as their midpoint, and therefore the sun is the center of the universe. And that was the third assumption of about seven, I believe, or so that Copernicus had concerning this. Now, when you were growing up, the science books are very different than they are today. In fact, in just this last generation, every science book has had to be rewritten. Because when you were growing up, or are growing up now, some of you, I should say, but if you're a little older, all the science books said that all the universe was made up of things called atoms. Isn't that right? It was made up of atoms. Well, now we don't believe that's true at all. Everything has to be written around, because now we believe that the universe is made up mostly of something that is called dark matter. And dark matter is something we really don't understand very well. We can measure its effects by its gravitational pull. It has gravitational pull. And so we think there's something out there. It's not made of atoms. You can't see it. We don't really know what it is. So it's called dark matter. But the question is it really even matter at all? Because according to Einstein, gravity isn't really a substance. Gravity is a force, but gravity is caused by a warping of the space-time. Well, what if there's energy warping space-time instead of matter warping space-time? And then we have a whole new ball game. Everything changes. So we have all these ideas about what makes up the center of everything. But the fact is, friends, there is a centrality of this universe, and that centrality is found in the life and the death of Jesus Christ. And the cross of Calvary is the true center of everything. It is the center of Christianity. Through the cross and the resurrection, we have been secured redemption, and we have hope brought into our world that we would not have without it. And today I want to tell you, I believe that the message of the cross is the message of the gospel. I believe that the cross is the focus of the gospel. It is the straw that stirs the drink. The Apostle Paul believed in it so strongly. He wrote something about it in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. In verse 1, "And I, brethren, when I came to you, came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and Him crucified." This was what Paul was preaching about. Now today, there are aspects of our lives that we need not ignore. Aspects of our health, our diet, our exercise, our livelihoods. We need not ignore those things. But you know, those aren't the things that we preach. The things that we preach are Christ and Him crucified. That's what Paul said that we preach. And he said, "I say to not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and Him crucified." How does this relate to Jesus and the preaching of Him and the cross? Now, in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, we're going to read some verses here. And it's going to appear that we're having a lesson in Greek today, but we're really not. We're just going to look at a few Greek words, though, that will help highlight, I think, and maybe help us to understand some of these things that we're reading, just with a little more depth, a little more clarity. But believe me, this will not be a Greek class today. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 17, Paul says, "For Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with words of wisdom, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect. For the preaching of the cross is unto them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved it is the power of God." Paul says it's not with intellectual wisdom, words of wisdom, that I preach this gospel. And in verse 18, he speaks about the preaching of the gospel. If we go down to verse 23, he says, "But we preach Christ crucified." And it's interesting here that in these three instances of using this word preach or preaching, they're all from different Greek words. They all have a different Greek word. In verse 17, the Greek word for, or in fact, it's the Greek word for the expression preach the gospel. That's all one word in the Greek. It's that word euangelisio, and it means simply the good news. It's the verb form of the word we translate good news for gospel. It's the preaching of it, the proclaiming of the good news. In verse 18, when he says for the preaching of the cross, that is actually the Greek word logos. The Greek word logos. In the beginning was the logos, and the logos was with God, John 1:1. We usually translate this word, logos, as word, but here it's translated preaching, because it also conveys not only the idea of words, but the idea of concepts, the idea of something that is working in our minds and bringing forth a result. But it says, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but to us which are saved, it is what? The power of God. It is the dunamis of God, the word we use to translate and get dynamite from. It is the dynamic power of God. And there's a statement in Spirit of Prophecy, Volume 3, page 167, that says, "When Christ died upon the cross of Calvary, a new and living way was opened to both the Jew and the Gentile." Paul's speaking here, and he says in verse 22, "For the Jews require a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom." But he says, "I've come to preach Christ and Him crucified." And this word in verse 23, when he says, "Therefore I'm preaching the Christ, I'm preaching the gospel," it is the Greek word kerusso, which means herald. You know, a herald would be someone who would run into the town and announce the news. So Paul says, "I have this good news, this concept of salvation that I am heralding out to everybody. And it has power, and it has power to save not only the Jew, who will seek after a sign, but also the Greek as well." The gospel has power, it's to be heralded out, and Paul said that was exactly what he was going to do. In Galatians chapter 3 and verse 1, he says, "O foolish Galatians, who hath bewitched you that you should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ hath been evidently set forth, crucified among you?" Christ has been what? He has been set forth. That word set forth is prographo in the Greek. And that comes from two Greek words that you will recognize. Pro meaning before. Grapho, like graphics, writing, the things. In other words, these were things that I wrote about before, that I've told you about before. And I'm telling you again, Paul was not going to let the cross of Christ be something that became stagnant or something that became a forgotten memory in those people. I believe today that the cross redeems us from the curse of the law, and I believe that because that's what the Bible says, friends. Suppose you knew that your best friend was infected with the Ebola virus. We've been hearing a little bit about that lately. It's a pretty bad thing. In fact, in our next slide, this is a man who died of Ebola. But suppose your best friend was infected. What would you be telling them now? Would you be telling them about the news of the stock market? Would you be telling them about the weather forecast? Now, you'd be telling them about treatment. We need to get to treatment, or we need to get to a hospital, or we need to do this or whatever, because this is serious and this affects us now. But friends, we're all infected with the disease of sin. And this is what should be the urgent message upon our lips that we should be heralding. This is the concept that we should be saying. This is the good news that we should be bringing, is that there is a Jesus Christ who died to pay the penalty for our sins. In Galatians chapter 3 and verse 13, it says, "Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us, For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. Because, friends, Jesus took our place, his substitutionary death, took us off the cross, as it were, and put us in vantage ground so that we could live. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21, Paul says, for he made him, that is, God made Christ, to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Friends, I believe it, don't you? I believe this. And this changes my life, and it changed your life too, if you believe it. It'll change your life in a dramatic way. And the cross brings life. In Galatians again, Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20, Paul says, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me, and the life which I live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Paul says, I live today. I have life. My experience, even if I am sick with physical disease, if I am handicapped, if I have legs amputated, if I have my hearing gone, if my eyesight is getting dim, I have a dear, dear brother in California whose eyesight is getting worse by the day, seemingly because of macular degeneration. And I'm praying for this dear brother. But friends, nothing can take his joy from him because he has Jesus living in his heart. And it doesn't matter what your situation is. Nothing can take the vibrancy of life away from you if you have Jesus. In John chapter 10, verse 10, Jesus says, I've come that they might have life and that they might have it how? More abundantly. Not just simply abundantly, but more abundantly. He wants us to have the abundant life. And this happens through his blood. This happens through his blood. This week, Brother Michael Woodward went to town and answered the call of the Red Cross and gave blood. Here he is afterwards, relaxing for a minute. And because of that donation of blood, within a month or so probably, three people will probably have life who couldn't have had life otherwise. Isn't that a blessing? What a wonderful thing. And he'll never meet those people. They'll never meet him. He'll never know who they were. They'll never know of him. But because he did something for them, they're going to live. And you know, friends, Jesus did something for us. Even when we didn't know him, when we didn't know of him even. Do you realize, friends, that there are still billions of people in this world who have never heard the name Jesus Christ? That seems hard for us to believe living in so-called Christian America, especially us here in the southern part of America who live in the, quote, Bible Belt. But there are literally billions of people in this world who know the name of Coca-Cola and have never heard Jesus Christ. There are billions of people in the world who recognize the golden arches and have never seen the cross of Christ. And I'm telling you the truth, that's not a joke. And what an indictment on us as Christians that we haven't done our job, friends, of sharing this good news, of heralding this good news, of this concept that someone took my place and died for me when I deserved to die. And he gave his blood for me. In Ephesians chapter 1, Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 7, in whom we have redemption through what? His blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. That's right, friends. All this enmity that we have had against God, all of this desire to rebel, it is smothered by the blood of Jesus through the cross once we come to a saving knowledge of that truth and accept him, surrender our life to him. In Ephesians chapter 2, since we're close to that, Ephesians chapter 2, verses 13 through 16, Paul says, but now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made what? Nigh by the blood of Christ. What does that word nigh mean? Mm-hmm. Close. You've been brought near by the blood of Jesus. For he is our peace, who hath made both one and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself of twain one new man, so making peace, so that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain or put to death the enmity thereby. Christ, through his blood upon the cross, has torn down the enmity, that hatred that we have, And that's why, friends, a murderer can become a saint. A murderer can become a saint by the grace of God, through the blood of Christ upon the cross. Because as he sees one who's dying for him, he gets it. Have you ever heard that expression, did they get it? Did you get it? That sinner who sees that Jesus died for him and sees the love of God in giving his son, he gets it. And it affects him and it changes him because love changes. This is the whole principle about by beholding we become changed. When we behold that love of God, it changes our heart into a heart of love from a heart of stone. God's promise in the New Covenant experience, friends, to give us a heart of flesh instead of a heart of stone, Ezekiel 36. And he's promised in Jeremiah 31 in the New Covenant experience again. Interestingly, these New Covenant texts from the Old Testament, right? Ezekiel 36, Jeremiah 31, that in Jeremiah 31 he promises to write his law where? In our hearts. Same law that was on stone, but now it's written in our hearts. And because it's written in our hearts, we want to do that law because we love him. We love what he's done for us. That enmity is gone, and only the cross can melt hearts and change them. And it is really, friends, that we're already dead. In Colossians chapter 2, verses 13 and 14. He says, and you, being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. You know, we don't think we're dead. We think we're alive. But the Bible says, in fact, we have died. We've had a death experience in trespasses and sins. Spiritually, we've all died. But Jesus says, I'm going to give you life by my blood. The Bible says in the verse just prior to this, verse 12, it says, buried with him in, by baptism. But we were raised up through his resurrection because of his death in the newness of life. And so he offers us this. It's no wonder that in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 19, that Peter calls the blood of Jesus precious. It's precious. It's dear. You know, our good friends in Australia, they have an expression they use a lot. It's called dear. That is very dear. And that means it was costly or expensive or important. Did you get any milk today at the store? No, it was too dear. It's too much. But the blood of Jesus, friends, it was dear. It was precious to us. And I'm thankful for it today. And I hope that you're thankful for it today. The cross is important and it is central to our experience because I believe the cross brings reconciliation and justification. I believe that, friends. And the reason I believe is because the Bible says it. In Romans chapter 4, in verse 25, Romans chapter 4, verse 25, it says, who was delivered for our offenses? Christ was delivered for what? Our offenses, our sins. It says also, though, and was raised again for our what? Justification. Justification. Does justification mean anything to you, friends? It should. It means you've been made right with God. It means you've been set right. That God accounts everything as right. God offers you that. And I believe that the cross brings this. In Romans chapter 5, verses 8 and 9, Romans chapter 5, verses 8 and 9 says, but God commendeth his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. Friends, because he died on the cross and shed his blood, he can now sprinkle his blood. He can minister his blood in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary and make atonement for his people. And even the sanctuary in heaven, it centers around the great act of Jesus dying upon the cross. In Colossians chapter 1, verses 20 through 22, he says, and having made peace through the blood of his cross to him to reconcile all things unto himself, by him I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven. And you that were sometime alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled. Verse 22, in the body of his flesh, through death, to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. And so he has done this for us through his blood upon the cross. There's a statement, a part of a page on A Desire of Ages I'd like to share with you. And it begins by saying this: through Jesus, God's mercy was manifested to man, but mercy does not set aside justice. The law reveals the attributes of God's character, and not a jot or tittle of it could be changed to meet man in his fallen condition. God did not change his law, but he sacrificed himself in Christ for man's redemption. God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19. Continuing, the law requires righteousness, a righteous life, a perfect character, and this man has not to give. He cannot meet the claims of God's holy law. But Christ, coming to earth as a man, lived a holy life and developed a perfect character. These he offers as a free gift to all who receive them. His life stands for the life of men. Thus they have remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. More than this, Christ imbues men with the attributes of God. He builds up the human character after the similitude of the divine character, a goodly fabric of spiritual strength and beauty. Thus, the very righteousness of the law is fulfilled in the believer in Christ. God can be just and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus, Romans 3:26. God's love has been expressed in his justice no less than in his mercy. Justice is the foundation of his throne and the fruit of his love. It has been Satan's purpose to divorce mercy from truth and justice. He sought to prove that the righteousness of God's law is an enemy to peace. But Christ shows that in God's plan, they are indissolubly joined together. The one cannot exist without the other. Mercy and truth are met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. Psalms 85 and verse 10. By his life and his death, Christ proved that God's justice did not destroy his mercy, but that sin could be forgiven, and that the law is righteous and can be perfectly obeyed. Satan's charges were refuted. God had given man unmistakable evidence of his love. And that's from The Desire of Ages, page 762. And you know, all of this, the forgiveness, the empowering, the character, it's all available to us, friends, because of the blood that Jesus spilled upon the cross of Calvary. Every bit of it. I believe, friends, that the cross is so strong that it destroys the power of Satan. And I believe that because the Bible tells us it does. In John chapter 12, notice what Jesus said. John chapter 12 and verse 31. Jesus says, "Now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out. Because of my perfect life and my death, he will be cast out." In Hebrews chapter 2, if we could turn back to Hebrews chapter 2, verses 14 through 15. Notice Paul says, "For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he," that is Jesus, "also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might do something." What is he going to do through his death? "Destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage." Friends, we don't have to be subject to bondage anymore. It doesn't matter what that bondage is. It could be we could be living as a slave to tobacco or to alcohol or to any kind of habit or any kind of sin. But friends, he wants to deliver us from that, and he's able to do it, and he's able to do it today, right now, for me and for you both. And he has the power to do that. And I believe, friends, that the cross destroys the power of Satan. I believe also, friends, though, that many people don't understand the cross and it has become a stumbling block or an offense to many. Let's go back to 1 Corinthians, where we started a little bit earlier. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. And we're going to read verse 22 and now 23 again, and also 24. "For the Jews require a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom. But We preach Christ crucified, unto the Jews a stumbling block, and unto the Greeks foolishness. But unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God, and the wisdom of God. Now it's interesting. He says the Jews ask for a sign. That word ask means simply what we think it means. It means request. When you ask for something, you're requesting. You're not demanding, you're asking, right? The Jews are a little more polite than the Greeks. They ask for a sign. But that word sign, as I mentioned earlier, is the Greek word semion. And it means something that is a miraculous or supernatural thing. And I just want to show you a few of the ways it's used in the New Testament. Keep your hand here in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. We're going to be coming back very shortly. But turn with me first to Matthew chapter 16. Matthew chapter 16 and verse 1. Notice it says, the Pharisees also with the Sadducees came, and tempting desired him that he would shew them a sign from heaven. He would shew or show them a sign from heaven. Something they could see. We want to see a miracle. But faith comes by what? Hearing, and hearing the word of God. And that's found in Romans chapter 10, verse 17, isn't it? And remember Eve? She saw the fruit. She saw that it was good. And she thought it was good. Yea, hath God said? The serpent told her. Yea, hath God said? Yes, God had said. And God said, you don't touch it. And we should listen to what God says, friends. That's what faith is. Faith comes by hearing, hearing the word of God. But these people, they wanted to see something. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7 says, we walk by faith and not by sight. But they wanted to see a miracle. They wanted to see something miraculous. In chapter 24 of Matthew, in verse 24, Jesus says, for there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they should deceive the very light. The Jews were looking for signs, and I tell you, a lot of people are looking for signs, they're looking for miracles today. In John chapter 6 and verse 30, again, they say therefore unto him, what sign shewest thou then, that we may see and believe thee? What doest thou work? What is this sign? This is the same word, semion, in the Greek. What sign are you going to show us so that we can believe? And a lot of people today, they feel the same thing. If you can show me something, I'll believe it. And I've been the recipient of several emails, multiple emails every day, been going back and forth on a discussion lately about the Holy Spirit. It's a very interesting discussion. But someone recently in this discussion interjected this. Well, my experience has proven this particular aspect of theology to be true because it shows in my experience. Well, friends, I want to tell you something. The experience doesn't count anything for truth. I'm sorry. The experience could be deadly wrong. There are people having all kinds of experiences. I can go down to a little church about a mile from here tomorrow morning, and they're going to tell me about the great experience they're having. And that experience is the truth and the proof that what they believe is right. Friends, it's not the proof of the truth that it's right or wrong. We can't go by signs. We can't go by feelings. We have to go by the Word of God. And these people, they were wanting a sign. In Revelation chapter 15 and verse 1, and I saw another sign in heaven. Great and marvelous, seven angels having the seven last plagues, for in them is filled up the wrath of God. He saw this sign. And signs are something you see. These kind of signs are things you see. This was something supernatural. Yes. Supernatural things do happen, friends. And this is what the Jews were wanting. The Jews asked, or they're a little more polite than the Greeks. The Jews asked for a sign. And they asked for a sign, didn't they? But let's go back now to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, where we were at earlier. And it says, and the Greeks seek after wisdom. But this word seek in the Greek means to demand. The Greeks demand. They call for wisdom. Sophia in the Greek. Sophia. It's the one word that's always translated wisdom in the New Testament. Sophia. And it means wisdom. And something that they could perceive intellectually. Remember the Greeks, they were the great mathematicians of their day. They developed geometry to a state that wasn't really improved upon for centuries. And they had the great philosophers, the Platos and the Aristotles. And if they could plan, if they could budget, and if they could calculate this plan of salvation and make it fit somehow into logic and reasoning. By the way, the word logos, we talked about earlier, That's the word we get our word logic from today. It says the Greeks seek after wisdom. And they were saying, in effect, the Jews said, if you can't show us, we don't believe it. The Greeks said, if you can't explain it, we don't believe it. And you know what, friends? To human eye, we can't explain nor show the cross of Christ. We accept it by faith. It makes no sense. The God of this universe, the creator of all things, the potentate who has power over all, he sends his only begotten Son, who is precious and pure and holy and undefiled, to this earth to die for sinners. That makes no sense. That doesn't have any logic at all. Not if you're a human being. Not if you're a fallen, sinful human being. It makes no sense at all to do that. And so the Greeks, they can't see it like that. But Paul says that there will be some. Those who are called will be, they will be able to believe, because they don't go by what they see. They don't go by the wisdom of the world. Christ is the enigma that neither Jew nor Greek in their natural state could accept. And the reason is because they weren't born again. Remember in John chapter 3 and verse 3, Jesus said, ye must be born again. Unless we are born from above and receive a new mind, we cannot understand these spiritual truths, friends. They won't make sense to us. But I believe that the cross, though a stumbling block, is the power of God unto salvation. There's a statement that's found in Series A of the Testimonies, number 9, page 62. It says, what is justification by faith? What is this work of Jesus dying upon the cross, shedding his blood for us? It is the work of God in laying the glory of man in the dust and doing for man that which it is not in his power to do for himself. When men see their own nothingness, they are prepared to be clothed with the righteousness of Christ. And in Job chapter 25 and verse 6, we are as humanity, you know, we're just like a worm. We're just a worm, friends. We have nothingness. Nothingness. But when we understand that, and we're not trying to find a sign or a miracle, when we're not trying to be able to logically calculate how it has to work and why we deserve this salvation, when we realize that we're but a worm, then God can bestow his salvation upon us through Christ. And the cross need not be a stumbling block to us anymore. I believe that the cross unites us to Jesus Christ. It is the chain, and nothing else can do that work. The Bible teaches that we are, in fact, and we read some of these verses earlier, and we won't read them all now, that we are, in effect, buried and raised with him. There's something about having experiences. When I was in college, I pledged a Greek fraternity called Theta Xi. This is their flag and coat of arms. And as I was pledging this fraternity, we had certain requirements of us as pledges. We were required to spend so many nights in the fraternity house during the semester as we were pledging. Now, we all lived in a dormitory or had an apartment somewhere else, all the pledges. But we were required, even though we had our own places, to stay in the fraternity house so many nights. You didn't stay so many nights, you didn't get in. It's that simple. And in fact, the more nights you stayed, the better. We were required to spend so many hours there, to attend so many functions, and we were given pledge projects where we had, as a group, to work together, to do different things. And I want to tell you, at the end of four months, there was a small group, there was about six of us left, out of about 16 that started. And we were a pretty close-knit group. And we became very close and brotherly, even brotherly, with those people in the fraternity. And this may seem strange to you. You know, we're talking about, in all honesty, a godless fraternity. It wasn't godless in the sense that it had no God. It had a God. Its God was Satan, I can tell you that. And I'm not proud of it today, but I'm just telling you that the very fact that we had these associations together, it did something that is always done in humanity when you have associations together like this. It's either going to make terrible enemies or it's going to build strong camaraderie. And ours was designed to build a strong camaraderie, and it did. I mean, we had guys that would have given their life for each other in that fraternity. Men who just would have cried over another guy's misfortune, who loved each other in a terribly deep and strong way. And yet, friends, we have the experience of the life and the death and the resurrection of Christ that we, as Christians, can become intimately associated with. And this is a bonding factor in our experience. Turn with me to Romans chapter 6. And we're going to start reading in verse 4. Romans chapter 6 and verse 4. It says, therefore, we are buried with him. Who's the him?
Christ.
We are buried with him by baptism unto death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in the newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. He says that our experience, it parallels with Christ because it is with Christ. That we have this experience, this intimate association with him. Turn with me to 2 Timothy 2:11. It is a faithful saying, for if we be dead with him, we shall also what? Live with him. Friends, don't expect to live with Jesus if you didn't die with him. Don't expect to be a Christian unless you're willing to accept the cross and the burden of the cross. It doesn't happen any other way. Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 3. He says, if ye then being risen, how? With Christ. Seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affections on things where? Above, not on the things on the earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. That is to be the experience that God wants us to have. I believe that the cross, without any question, unites us with Jesus Christ because the Bible says it does. I believe the cross is a symbol of our discipleship. And I believe that because the Bible teaches it. In Matthew chapter 16 now, in verse 24, then said Jesus unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. You know, I'm glad Jesus didn't read it this way or say it this way. If any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up my cross and follow me. Jesus didn't say to take up my cross. We are to take up our cross. His cross is too heavy for us. His cross is too difficult for us. But the cross he gives us, we are to pick up. And this symbolism of the cross, it represents our discipleship. And friends, without it, we have none. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 8. He says, Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of what? The cross. Even the death of the cross. And this cross is what discipleship is all about. Having the mind of Jesus is willing to accept the principle of the cross, the principle of the cross, that everyone else comes before me. Everyone else comes before me. In Selected Messages, Book 1, on page 224, we read this. Profound theories and speculations of human creation may abound, but he who would come off conqueror in the end must be humble enough to depend upon divine power. When we thus grasp the power of infinity and come to Christ saying, in my hand no price I bring, simply to thy cross I cling, then divine agencies can cooperate with us to sanctify and purify the life. Let no one seek to evade the cross. It is through the cross that we are enabled to overcome. It is through affliction and trial that divine agencies can carry on a work in our lives that will result in the love and peace and kindness of Christ. Select the Messages, Book 1, page 224. In Luke chapter 14, Jesus speaks about this emphatically. Luke 14, 27. Jesus says, "And whosoever doth not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple." In other words, he makes it emphatic. You see that, don't you, Brother Mike? Brother Mike's looking up at me, and he's been listening very carefully. I appreciate that. This is an emphatic. This is a must-be situation. If we're not willing to accept the cross that Christ lays upon us, we cannot be his disciple. It's just that simple. Though your burden may seem heavy at times, remember, as E. Stanley Jones said, Christ is always closest when the cross is heaviest. I like that. Sometimes, you know, when we're under the most distress, we're the sickest, we're the most discouraged, we're the most despondent, friends, that's when Christ is the closest to us. In Galatians chapter 5 and verse 24, Paul says, "And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and the lusts." They have accepted the principle of the cross. They've put self away, and they've accepted that they're nothing but a worm, not even as good as a worm, not even as the dust of the ground. In Galatians chapter 6 and verse 14, "But God forbid that I should glory, save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world." Paul says, "I don't glory in anything except the cross of Jesus Christ." Now, that's true. We don't put up crosses in our churches. We're told in great controversy, papists place crosses in their churches, and they put a lot of them there, because they take a lot of thought about a piece of wood instead of the act upon the cross. And we need to keep our minds focused upon the act of the cross. But friends, I'm not afraid to talk about the cross. I'm not afraid to exalt the cross. I love the old rugged cross, don't you? I love the old rugged cross. And there are people that are called the Jehovah's Witnesses. And they are what we might call anti-cross, sort of. They don't like to talk about the cross. They don't want to display a cross or make any mention of a cross hardly in any way. And one of them said to me one time, said, "Well, you know, what if your son was killed by a drunk driver? Would you take the bumper of the car and hang it up in your house, you know, as a memorial to your son?" Well, that's a very different situation. That's comparing apples and oranges, friends. That's comparing apples and oranges. If my son, to save someone, stepped out in front of a car and pushed someone out of the way, I would glory in the act of what he did. And that bumper would be a reminder to me of his great sacrifice. But the cross, friends, is a wonderful thing. We need never be afraid of the cross. We don't worship the cross, but we worship the one upon the cross and what he did there for us. "I should glory save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ." Spurgeon said, "There are no crown wearers in heaven that were not cross bearers here below." No one will wear a crown in heaven who would not bear a cross below. I found a poem I wanted to share with you. It says, "I counted dollars, why God counted crosses. I counted gains, why he counted losses. I counted my worth by the things gained in store. But he sized me up by the scars that I bore. I coveted honors and sought for degrees. He wept as he counted the hours on my knees. And I never knew till one day at a grave how vain are all these things that we spend life to save." I don't know about you, but that poem touched me. It touched me. Now, we started with a little bit of science today, and I told my Sabbath school we'd be ending with a little bit of science today. Perhaps you've heard of a man by the name of Albert Einstein, the famous E equals MC squared. Do you know what C stands for?
Speed of light.
Now, it's written as a C here. And that C has two symbolisms. One is that this is actually a formula that's designed to use the speed of light as measured at centimeters per second squared. Now, remember, there's a meter is about a yard long. If you're in English, you know yard is about a meter. But in 1 meter, there's 100 centimeters. So you think, how many of those 100 centimeters light goes in a second? And that's a lot. It's a big, big number. It's a big, big number. We know that light travels approximately 298,000 kilometers a second. It's very fast. It only takes 8 minutes for the light from the sun to get here, even though it's 93 million miles away. So it's pretty fast stuff. But C is also something we call a constant in science, a constant. The speed of light is considered, perhaps in some respects, the most fundamental number in existence, because it's a constant, and so many things are affected by the speed of light and are calculated by the speed of light and are necessary to the speed of light. However, I'm going to let you in on a scientific secret that most of the scientists don't want you to know, and that is that through the centuries and even through the last several decades, the measuring of the speed of light has not been constant. The measuring of the speed of light has not been constant. It's very interesting. Well, if we would go back a little in history, the ancient Greeks thought that light was instantaneous. It really didn't speed. It just was there. Galileo, he came up with the idea that light was probably at least 10 times faster than sound. We knew sound traveled. We knew sound had a finite traveling speed. And so light was maybe 10 times faster. And that was as recently as about 400 years ago. But then, in 1675, they deduced that the speed of light was probably around 200,000 kilometers a second. And that's starting to get in the ballpark now. And then in 1728, it went up to 301,000 kilometers a second. And then in 1849, it started getting a little more accurate in some ways, but it was 313,000 kilometers and 300 extra. And then in 1862, it went down to 796 kilometers per second, and today we know that it is exactly 299,792.458 kilometers per second. We know that it is exactly that, and I'll explain why we know it's exactly that in a minute. But I should also tell you that during the 1920s and 1930s, as they were measuring the speed of light, in fact, and you can verify this by going back and getting old textbooks, just get physics textbooks that were printed in these times, look up what the speed of light is. And you'll see that the speed of light was starting to slow down. Not by much, just a few kilometers per second. But it was slowing down. And they said, well, that's because we're using better instruments to measure by. We have more accurate instruments now. But the same instruments they used 10 years before, they used them in the same exact way, and they got slower results. And it happened not just in one laboratory, but in places all over the world. And so what they would do for several years is they were calculating the speed of light. They would take all these different numbers from all these places around the world, some a little faster, some a little slower, and they would average them. And this was the speed of light. But even though they were getting better instruments to measure it with, they were consistently getting slower speeds and using the same kind of processes everywhere. So how did science solve this conundrum? Well, they did it in a very interesting way. They decided that they would define the speed of light by the meter, okay? But then they defined the meter by the speed of light. Did you get that?
Yeah.
They defined the speed of light based upon the meter, but the meter is a basis of how fast light goes in a certain time frame. And so now they know the speed of light will always be this exact value that I just told you. It's always going to be that. But, of course, the kilometer could change. Or no, the kilometer can't change, they say now. You see the conundrum that we have? But this has all kinds of ramifications. Because this idea that the speed of light is slowing down. One scientist theorized that the speed of light at one time was perhaps 10 billion times faster than it is today. That's the one with 10 zeros after it. How could that be? How could that be? Well, one thing it affects this formula that we had back here a little bit ago. If we go back to Albert Einstein here, I'm sorry. E equals mc squared. Now, the speed of light, if it's 290,000 kilometers per second, but in a kilometer, there's 1,000 meters, and then there's 100 of those, so it's 100,000 times that number. So if you take 100,000 times 290,000, that's how many centimeters light travels in a second. But that's at the speed that we know now, or the approximate speed we know now. But now multiply that by a billion, and then multiply it by itself because it's squared. And you know what it says? It says that that in matter there was a tremendous amount of energy that we don't even begin to understand. It doesn't exist in matter today for some reason. It also tells us something about this. Scientists are very confirmed in this concept called evolution, that this Earth is about 4 to 5 billion years old. The universe is around 10, 12, maybe 15 billion years old. And we base this upon, to a great degree, upon carbon dating, radiometric dating. But did you realize that that's based on the speed of light? Mm-hmm. And the faster light goes, the slower the decay rate will show. And if it's slower, then it shows that it's older. And so if light has actually been faster in the past, then that means that instead of living in a very, very old Earth, we actually may be living in a very young Earth, scientifically. Scientifically. And so I was dwelling upon this yesterday. I was thinking on these things because I like to study physics. I started to take a physics minor in college, and due to certain events, I dropped out of that. I did several of the classes, didn't finish them enough to get the minor, but I like physics. I enjoy reading it, and I enjoy studying it. And so I'm asking myself, just, why is this like this? And I believe God spoke to my heart in a way He speaks to me, and just out of the blue, this idea came in mind, so people know I'm God. So they'll know I'm God. Because you see, friends, scientifically, if the speed of light is not a constant, then I'm going to tell you that everything that we know about cosmology and scientific physics, almost everything has to go out the door if it's not a constant. And God's going to tell people like us, puny people who get to the point in our existence that we think we know everything and we think we now have found the God particle and we think we understand how everything works, you don't know anything at all yet. You don't know anything at all yet. You're just a worm in the dust of the ground, and you need to start all over again. And He wants to help us, friends. But God may be illustrating just how little we really know and how much He knows, and not only that, but how powerful He is and what He can do for us to help us. And it is through the cross, friends, that we have the power of God given to us. We cannot save ourselves, and each day He helps us to understand this, and He offers us the life of His Son in our place. It is impossible for us to save ourselves. Only by the efficacy of the blood of Jesus Christ can we be saved. He died on Calvary's cross for us, and we may be complete in Him, for His sacrifice is all sufficient. Why will you keep your eyes fastened on self when your Savior stands beside you, saying, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. Yea, I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. Lay your sins on me." Review and Herald, September 15, 1896. That's what God's saying to each one of us today. That we can lay our sins upon His Son, Jesus Christ, and we can have an end to the struggle of sin. We can have an end to the struggle of constantly falling. It doesn't mean there won't be challenges. It doesn't mean we won't have to still fight the good fight of faith. But friends, we can fight victoriously in Jesus. He's made all this available for us, and I believe it's true with all my heart. And I want you to believe it too, friends. May God bless you each, lots and lots.